So we're ready to start our next panel, which is called Big Data and Criminal Justice. And we're really, really lucky to have a spectacular moderator in Julie Angwin, who's a senior reporter at ProPublica. Everyone keeps giving shout outs to her incredible report, which just came out today. It's probably one of the main reasons that big data is trending so much. We'll have to check to see if Angwin is trending as well. Julia is an award-winning investigative journalist at the independent news organization ProPublica from 2000 to 2013. She was a reporter at the Wall Street Journal, where she led a privacy investigation team and was a finalist for a Pulitzer Prize in explaining reporting in 2011 and won a Gerald Loeb Award in 2010. Her book, Dragnet Nation, A Quest for Privacy, Security, and Freedom in a World of Relentless Surveillance, was published by Times Books in 2014. In 2003, she was on a team of reporters at the Wall Street Journal that was awarded the Pulitzer Prize, so second time's a charm. And you explained the reporting coverage of corporate corruption. She was also an author of Stealing My Space, The Battle to Control the Most Popular Website in America on Random House. Julia will take us through this panel on big data and criminal justice. Thanks.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Yes. It's such an honor to be here with an incredible lineup of panelists. I want to start with Clarence Wardell on my left, who's he's really, I think, probably best known to all of you as the co-founder of the Police Data Initiative at the White House. He's been at the White House for 6 months and previously was a Presidential Innovation Fellow and his PhD from Georgia Tech and affiliated with the Berkman Center at Harvard. On my right, we have Ray Austin, who's the Director of the Office of Urban Affairs, Justice, and Opportunities at the White House. He started as a civil rights prosecutor and spent many years in private and public practice. And he doesn't know this, but he and I are both University of Chicago alums, so that's a good place to learn about policing, actually. So I'm just gonna start with a little bit of an introduction of how I see criminal justice and big data as a reporter covering that topic, among others. In my view, I think we're in very early days for what we know about what data can do for our policing and criminal justice system in this country. I think that the way I look at it is sort of like AA. You know, the first step towards recovery is recognizing you have a problem. And I think what we are kind of in the midst of is a two-year awakening about policing practices in America and criminal justice, and an awakening to the problem and questions about solutions. And, you know, the White House has been really involved in all those kind of questions. You know, there are possibilities that police, you know, that data could really help policing, right? And we've heard a lot about predictive policing, and some people see that as scary, finding crime hotspots, which would just mean more over-policing in minority neighborhoods. But predictive policing could also mean figuring out which police officers are really the problems and predicting their behavior and removing them from situations where they might cause problems. So there are opportunities for that. Just the way that there are ways to intervene with high-risk youths who might be, you know, in trouble, and this is something Chicago has been pioneering. And if you're intervening to help people find a path other than crime, it's also a great opportunity. And data can help with that. But of course, there are problems. And, you know, I've just spent the past year investigating the problems with one particular thing, which is risk assessment algorithms used in the criminal justice system. So I got interested in this topic when, in 2014, when then Attorney General Eric Holder asked the U.S. Sentencing Commission to investigate whether risk assessments used in sentencing had potential for racial bias. That investigation did not occur. The Sentencing Commission studied some other things. So we at ProPublica decided to do the investigation. And it took more than a year. My team is here with me, Jeff Larson and Lauren Kirshner, and we're really proud that we were able to do a pretty comprehensive look at risk assessment algorithms. And we studied one of the commercial software packages that is used across the nation. And what we found was that a strange thing, which is that it's basically predictive. 61% of the time it's right in its prediction of whether you're going to go on to commit a future crime. Now, 61% is not great, but it is better than a coin toss. And weirdly, it was about 61% right for blacks and whites. But it was wrong differently. So blacks were twice as likely to be wrongly listed as high risk, and whites were twice as likely to be listed wrongly as low risk. So although the overall predictive accuracy was the same, the way it failed was different. And you know, that is something that really led me to think that maybe we should be looking at failure rates. Maybe that is the way we should be testing our algorithms, because especially when something high stakes that is used in sentencing, pretrial release, parole decisions, all of these things involving liberty or incarceration, knowing who it's failing for and why is a really important question. I would like to point out that this algorithm is used for sentencing in Wisconsin, New York, and San Francisco. So all of these jurisdictions, not all of them actually, some of these jurisdictions had done their own studies of this tool. Some had not quite gotten around to it. But they did a different test. They just said, is it equally predictive for blacks and whites? And so I think that we have to think about what are the kinds of tests that we want to ask. And you know, I don't think that would be answered actually by seeing the algorithm itself. Late last night, as we were going to publish, the company actually did provide me, after much pressure, a very rudimentary algorithm. They said I couldn't share it with all of you, but I saw it, and I defy any prosecutor or lawyer to look at that equation and say, this is definitely going to be biased against my defendant. You need to see all the data, and you need to really see the outputs, right? What we saw was we analyzed 7,000 people's scores and their future criminal records. That's when we saw the bias. You don't see it when you see the equation. So that's my view of where criminal justice and data has led us. It has led us to an unfortunate situation where a risk assessment tool, which is really designed and pushed by people who are very, very reform-minded. It's actually part of a movement to remove bias from the system, and a well-intentioned movement, and yet it sadly ended up reinforcing bias. And so I think we now have to come up with new ways to evaluate such tools, and right now the academic community can really help come up with maybe those standards. But I would like to hear from both of you about how you guys think big data can help and hurt, and we'll start with Roy.
Well, thank you so much. And you know, let me start with where I started with big data, and that was in my dad's office. My dad was a criminologist at Penn State University, and my start with big data was with the binary cards, where they had the punch cards, which many of you probably have no idea that this is where it started. Little, I don't even know, maybe like 2-inch by 3-inch cards, and I used to build forts with those. And so that was my start with big data. Was building these forts sitting in his office because I had no idea why he had all these cards with all these holes in them. And then I went on to become a civil rights prosecutor. And I noticed that as a civil rights prosecutor, we were prosecuting these cases all over the country. Hate crimes is what I'm thinking of right now. Hate crimes cases all across the country. And then went to look at the data on it. And if you look at the most recent FBI data on hate crimes, you will find that California reported somewhere in the neighborhood of 800 hate crimes in 2014. That's the most recent data that we happen to have. Alabama has 9, Mississippi 1. Now that is the data that we are reporting as a federal government of hate crimes around the country, which I heard at least one person laugh, is laughable. And really is not helpful as we're trying to determine how many hate crimes are around the country, what those hate crimes are for, who's being targeted with these hate crimes. I then had a chance to work on a case involving the California Highway Patrol. This is Rodriguez versus California Highway Patrol. And this was the idea that the California Highway Patrol had started doing drug interdiction. And it had its officers going around the state stopping people. So the question was, well, how are they basing these stops and how are they deciding who to search? And this really was something which Thurgood Marshall had pointed out in a case many years before. They had nothing. They basically were taking cars and they were saying, well, this one car I stopped that had drugs and it was going too fast. And this other officer, well, this one car that I stopped was going too slow. And so they decide, well, either you're going too fast or you're going too slow. And it moved on to it had a car seat or it didn't have a car seat. It went on to it had bumper stickers or it didn't have bumper stickers. And they were really and truly using this as the basis for these stops. And they were collecting data really more or less in their heads as to who to stop and who not to stop based on what were really random decisions and at the end of the day turned out to be biased decisions. And this was a case I had the privilege of working on with Michelle Alexander over at the, when she was at the ACLU and I was at a law firm in San Francisco. More recently, I've been kind of on this 7-year tirade about our crime statistics and how absolutely horrible they are, and really in many ways worthless they are. And that is that we publish these uniform crime reports about crime in America. It comes out too late. It is inaccurate. It is based on whatever any city or mayor or police chief decides to put in them. Some would even question the homicide statistics that are in there. There was a large report pointing out that the homicide statistics in Chicago were inaccurate. Chicago can do a lot of things very well. And so this is something which we just have really, really bad crime data. And right now there's a question of where's violent crime in America right now? And the real problem is no one knows. Absolutely no one knows. And that's insane to me that in this country, in this day and age, where I have better fantasy football numbers than I have crime numbers, it's a big problem. How can we talk about public safety? How can we talk about recidivism and risk assessment if we have no idea how much crime is happening in a particular community? And the problem right now is that it has to be voluntary, is that there is no one who is requiring that we collect crime numbers, that every single police agency around the country collect crime numbers. And so using that, I will use that to pass it on to Clarence, on how we use this voluntary collection of data to hopefully get to a better place in the near future.
Clarence.
Am I cue?
Yes.
Well, thanks for having me today. So I guess I'll talk briefly, you mentioned it at the top, about the Police Data Initiative. One of the core efforts, at least from the White House side, coming out of the President's Task Force on 21st Century Policing. The effort dates back probably, honestly, about a year and a half at this point. And we started this work around the same time that the president actually stood up his task force on policing. Is familiar to everyone here, it was fall of 2014, post-Ferguson, when a lot of these issues between about the lack of trust and in many places where trust never existed between police and communities of color came to the surface. And it was really interesting to me, kind of sitting here in D.C. at the time and being someone who is kind of fairly data-oriented, to hear the extent to which data became almost a central part of the conversation. And not just data for data's sake, but this notion of transparency and what it meant for people to trust the agency that was policing and serving their community. So at that time, the top level on all of this was essentially this notion of, or the reality of, that we have just really bad data around officer-involved shootings in this country. And since then, kind of a lot of folks have taken up that mantle from the Washington Post here, Fatal Encounters, and other folks who have been doing kind of these crowdsourced databases, the Guardian as well. But even beyond that is this larger notion of just generally, we just don't have good data on policing in this country broadly. And which is something that is, as Roy said, even just beyond the crime piece, but I think the thing that we start to understand a little bit more, especially when you look at the analysis that the DOJ civil rights did post-Ferguson, right? It wasn't really the use of force or the officer-involved shooting data that was really interesting. What was really interesting was the fines and the type of fines that were being levied on particular pockets of that community, right? And how that, over time, manifested itself into distrust between police and the citizens. And so this notion of that we have one of the probably the most fundamental relationships to a democracy where we have really no data about what that looks like in practice, no data to evaluate policies, let alone any of the algorithms, right? So we don't understand what do the policies look like and how do those actually manifest themselves within our community. The stop and frisk is a prime example of that, right? This notion of we're driving crime down, but how are we affecting the people that live in those communities? And what does that do to trust over the long term? And so what we really saw this as an opportunity. I was working at the time, myself and colleague Denise Ross, who some of you may know, came from City of New Orleans, had helped stand up their open data program down there. And we had really moved to this point, especially in the administration almost from day one. The Obama administration talked a lot about how they wanted to infuse open data across the government, primarily in this lens of business creation, but also just good governance. We really saw it as an opportunity to bring that same lens to the policing community, to a space that, let alone trying to get crime data out, but data about police themselves was virtually almost impossible. And I think we walked in, me and Denise walked into Roy's office and we said, well, hey, we got an idea. We want to do open data in policing. And then after Roy asked us what is open data, I think he may have let out a chuckle around this idea that we would get police departments to voluntarily share their data in a way that would kind of lend itself to increased accountability and transparency. But it really was a credit, and I always make sure to do this, a credit in large ways to the conversation and to the movement and to the grassroots on the ground that helped shape this conversation and really move us to a place where transparency and this idea that if you're going to police the community, you at the very least, right, be able to share data about what that looks like in practice. And so that was kind of the genesis of the Police Data Initiative. And it was this idea in many respects of how do we bring police together with technologists, data scientists, community activists, and use data as a way to have a conversation and to build trust through transparency. And our play on this is very fundamental and very basic. And sometimes it boggles the mind that it is even a thing that is noteworthy in some respects. But it's essentially we're asking departments to commit to releasing at least 3 data sets around police-citizen interactions. And so it's a lot less about crime, but things like officer-involved shootings, use of force, traffic and pedestrian stops, even things like community engagement and community meetings attended and things of that nature. And so at this point, it's about a year in, and I think as DJ mentioned, going on across town right now in a parallel world is the 1 year, and a new report just came out today, 1 year progress of the Task Force on 21st Century Policing. What does implementation look like? And so in there, they talk a little bit about the Police Data Initiative. Really kind of two tracks to it. On the open data side, we now have 56 departments who have committed to working towards releasing at least 3 data sets around transparency. We've released at this point 100 data sets with hopefully many more in the offing. And I guess one kind of piece to this is it's a commitment to work toward releasing data. And it's not a commitment necessarily to release the data right away. And I think one of the things that we do a disservice to and some things that frustrates me a little bit when I read some of the newspaper articles at times is that this work is not easy work. It's not easy for a lot of these departments. And it is a new vocabulary, a new language the departments are now having to speak and think about. Their systems that they originally procured didn't have open data and this notion of transparency in mind. And so I've actually been really encouraged by the work and the way that a lot of the departments and leadership has stepped up to this. We've seen a lot of support from the external communities and stakeholders, folks like Code for America, researchers, I think it's Hare School at UChicago and their data science program, Police Foundation, International Association of Chiefs of Police. And I think it is a fairly unique thing in the sense of that it does require both sides, right? Not just law enforcement, but law enforcement working together with folks who have a vested interest in this and who are willing to take the time to help them open up this data and use it really as a tool. In our lens on a lot of this is a tool for engagement. It's certainly just the first step. We were talking behind the stage. There's a lot more work to be done to understand standardization. What does use of force mean in Cincinnati versus D.C.? The officer involved shooting is really, in a lot of ways, is the low-hanging fruit. And we've still got a lot of ways to go to really understand what does policing look like in America. I'll stop there. I know we have a lot of questions and discussion.
That's great. So how many agencies did you say again?
56
voluntarily. So, okay, so how do we get the rest of them to do this? Is there, I mean, this is, I think, the big question, right? You have a decentralized criminal justice and policing are essentially all run at county and state levels, and the federal government's ability to influence is limited. And so the question is, how do you even get some standards, you know, across, like you said, use of force? I did a story last year about the use of flashbang grenades by police forces. Yep. And the force that I was looking at didn't consider it a use of force, so they didn't file any use of force reports on it. It was just routine policing activity, walking in someone's house and throw a thing that is hotter than lava when it explodes at a person. Like, okay, that's rocking. So, you know, is there a way to build standards, or is that doable?
I think there's definitely a way to build standards. It's a great question, and it's like the use of force one is one that we've seen, and even the FBI kind of punted on this late last year at the APB meeting, because it's a difficult one. I mean, we had a discussion, and I think it's Cincinnati. They break out, you know, when an officer pulls a gun, right? They may not fire it, but like even the threat of force is considered use of force, but that's actually a separate category there. Whereas in some place like Austin, Texas, that's all lumped into use of force. I think the thing that the approach that we've taken, I've certainly had folks quibble with that approach. We stayed away a bit from standards up front, really being focused on how do we build the muscle and the mechanics to help departments release the data. And I think we also thought up front that this notion of standards might be used as an excuse for departments not to participate when they say, well, I can't release the data in that way, so let me wait a little bit longer. But on the flip side of that, we've also seen where we've had departments who are interested in participating in the initiative and or trying to figure out how to get started. They're kind of saying, well, what is everyone else doing? Or is there a standard or a template that I can follow? So there's definitely a balancing act. I think one of the things that we've been encouraged by is the level of innovation that we've seen. When you start out a process and you don't kind of impose these top-down standards, we're starting to actually see best practices, where some departments are leaning really, really far forward in terms of what they're sharing, and others aren't doing as much, either because they just don't want to. The laws within their particular municipality or state don't allow for that, or their systems might not be equipped to even collect that data to begin with. I think now, as we've started to mature a little bit more, we're starting to at least surface some of those standards and create a space now where hopefully we can provide a little bit more guidance. And as other departments are starting to see this around the country in best practice, feeling more comfortable coming into that space. I think early on, a lot of our thesis, and you hear Ron Davis, who's the director of the Cops Office, talks about, you know, how any great innovation within policing in particular has always started with, you know, whether it's 10 or 20 kind of forward-leaning jurisdictions and departments around the country, across the country, hopefully, we'll start to see that there's really not an excuse anymore not to participate. And what we've also found is that when you put it fundamental to policing and good policing, right, is this notion of trust and legitimacy. And it has been our thesis from the beginning that this transparency, data sharing is core to that. It's not the only thing that leads to that, but it's core to it. And so starting to put it in the frame of this is just what has to happen for good policing to occur.
Mm-hmm. What about you? What do you think about the federal government's role in influencing the data quality?
Yeah, so I know that the FBI right now is starting to push onto standards around use of force, and they've brought together all the major organizations, and I think the fact that so many are doing it voluntarily has made that process easier, and they're going to be coming out with standards sometime this fall on use of force. Again, the problem we're going to have is that it's still voluntary, and so the reporting, I suspect, for the first few years is going to be terribly incomplete. So the federal government has, you know, a couple levers that it can use. It can use its grant making a little bit, where it can say that, you know, we're going to prioritize certain agencies that publish its funding or publish its use of force data, and that it'll make determinations like that. But really, what we've created is this community of practice, and so the White House has said this is a good way to move forward, and we have 56 agencies covering 40 million people. So at this point, we have 7 of the 10 largest police agencies who've agreed to join the Police Data Initiative. And so by housing this in the federal government, we have a way to really spread the word on this and get more and more people engaged on it. And Clarence is absolutely right about the fact that it doesn't take us to set the standards. They're going to start setting the standards, then more importantly, communities are going to start setting the standards. And that's where we really need to reach. We need community people to start looking at these data sets and demanding them, because there are 18,000 police departments around the country. We have 50 plus that are now engaged on this, but we have 40 million people who are engaged on it. It's going to take members of every single community to go to their police department and say, hey, this is working. And then you have Dallas saying, you know what, we had an officer-involved shooting, but the fact that we could actually show how few officer-involved shootings we have compared to the number of citizen police interactions we have helped to take the temperature down. You have agencies saying how, you know what, we are saving money on FOIA requests because we just tell people, you know, journalists like yourself, it's right there. It's right out there. We don't need to go digging through our data when it is right out there. We have agencies saying that, we had an agency say that they did not actually know the diversity of their department. They put out some numbers, but until they were forced to do it in a way that was transparent, it was the first time they had to check back and say, oh, wait, the numbers we've been putting out there were actually wrong because they weren't transparent, because we didn't have officers able to even look themselves and say, you know, we have more than five Latino officers, or we have fewer than five Latino officers. But by putting it out there and making it transparent, it actually made for better data. And so getting that message across the country is the way that we're going to get more and more involved.
Sadly, I don't seem to be running across any of these agencies that are offering me great, vast data sets.
Well, come talk to us. We'll punch this up. No, but I will say, I mean, and I think perhaps even more relevant for this conversation is, well, what are the standards? Like, what standards? Like, if I was tomorrow, you know, said Congress was going to impose some standards for use of force, data collection, that they would all, every department across the country by the end of the year would have to put forward on their website. Like, what would we be comfortable with, right? And one of the things that we're having a conversation now is around this balance between privacy and transparency, which is a really hard line to walk. One of the things that we discovered, and you know, I will say I was fairly was a blind spot for me as we started this work, was essentially the sensitivities around sexual assault and domestic violence data. On the one hand, right there, if you completely redact and remove that data from your data set, it almost looks like these events aren't occurring in our community. On the other hand, if you lean too far forward on that, you run the risk of possible re-victimization. And so what we're having right now, and we had an event on this last month in partnership with DOJ, Office of Violence Against Women, as well as the VP's office, is looking at what are the implications for open data on policing and for this community. I think that's in the absence of kind of mandated standards, I think that giving space for those conversations and that learning to occur is critical. And I think it runs the risk if we impose some standards too soon, in a lot of ways of, you know, we've seen legislation, right, that you talked about in your article for, you know, some of these risk-based scores being now encoded into law, and runs the risk too soon of actually encoding some of these things that we don't have the downstream implications for yet.
That's right. The sentencing bill that's pending in Congress includes the requirement of using a certain risk score throughout the federal prison system. Was not the score that I tested, but I would like to see it tested. But I think that where you talk about the line between privacy and transparency, like, that means a lot to me, right? I, as a journalist, I'm always fighting for transparency. I also just wrote a book about privacy and the importance of privacy. And nowhere do you see this more closely than with body cams, right? Because of course, there's a feeling that if we just somehow had video, and this did happen in Chicago, having video of an officer-involved shooting did bring much-needed transparency to a situation, and probably many situations. But at the same time, we've seen a huge amount of police manipulation in Chicago of the audio on their dashboard cameras, of the cameras themselves, and there's a definite concern that you know, what would happen is it's basically that only one person in this transaction has a camera and gets to shape the video. And so I'm curious what you guys think of where is the line on that?
So I can't, you know, sit here right now and say, here's the line. You can you know, here are the two people who can see the video, or here are the 10 people who can see the video, here are the 10 people who can't see it. And I think that this is, it's really telling, because body cameras are really new. I mean, we've had dash cameras for a little while. The number of people now with cell phones with cameras is actually relatively new to this entire industry and to policing and everything else. But drawing that line, because I was also a domestic violence sexual assault prosecutor for a long time. Do you want a camera in there when you are talking to your sexual abuse victim? But it's a crime, and you want to make sure that you're capturing, because I also know domestic violence victims oftentimes end up reversing themselves. So to have that on tape would be huge for the prosecution of domestic violence cases. At the same time, are they going to call the police if they know that what they just, you know, what they're telling, their most intimate stories about this relationship are going to be out there and everyone's going to see it? So there has to be a balance there over who gets to see it. I mean, same thing with sexual abuse cases. I mean, do you want a child sexual abuse victim on camera where everybody can see it? And is that going to, in some ways, disincentivize the reporting of this crime? So, I mean, we talk about kind of the citizen police interaction that happens out on the street that's already public. And, you know, most likely that's an easy case of, yes, let's put it out there. Let's let people FOIA it. Let the police put it out there. But at the same time, even in those interactions, there are things that come out that we don't want every single neighbor that we have to know everything that happened in that interaction. And so do we want to just put everything out there willy-nilly, or do we want to have some set of standards? And that's got to be created by the community at some point. It can't be the federal government saying, you know what, here's the line, we've decided this is exactly what should come out, because all of this is in many ways new to the federal government as well. And so I don't think that we are in a position necessarily to design and to say these are the exact standards that we're going to have moving forward.
It's time for questions. So if people want to queue, are there microphones around? Can take questions. In the meantime, do you have something to say about body cams?
No, I was just going to punt to Harlan in the back.
Okay.
Actually, my question's about body cameras.
Okay.
Let's just go right from there, because that's fascinating. My name's Susan Crawford. I teach at Harvard Law School. And I had some students working with an American city this past term on body camera policies. And it became obvious to us that what we were doing was calling different departments to find out what they were doing. So based on your experience with the Police Data Initiative, what's the best way to move forward on developing these very tricky policies in a community of practice around what gets redacted, what gets displayed, what gets collected, when the camera's on and off? What's the best way to move forward?
Yeah, I mean, I will say, I think the body cam one is just really hard. But what we've done, and I guess I failed to mention this up front, a big component of the Police Data Initiative is this notion of a community of practice. And we don't just, I know sometimes people just kind of say it's a community of practice and kind of all like-minded folks. We actually do, we've now moved to, because it's grown a bit, but we do essentially bi-weekly stand-up calls where we have every department call in over a 30-minute period, and just kind of report out on what are their progress process for releasing the data, what have been some of their successes, what have been some of their challenges, and trying to get some of that cross-pollination going. We found that to be fairly successful, particularly in the, I mean, just full transparency, one of the bigger issues the departments have struggled with is how to represent use of force data within a data set for a particular incident when you may have three or four officers involved, and how does that translate itself over time. And that's been one that the departments have started to kind of like feel their way through by seeing what's working here, what's not working there. And so I think that dialogue and providing space for that is important. And I think to Roy's point, and just my only answer has really been on the body cam piece is allowing space for that type of innovation in some space within like reasonable guardrails. I think that the best thing that whether it's state or local or federal governments can do is as they're putting money into these new technologies is to do it in a way such that we're learning over time. And I think that, you know, this is, you know, for a lot of these policies and a lot of these things, we don't really know what the downstream ramifications and effects are until maybe a decade or so from now. So I think we can start to say something now about some of the, you know, what does this look like when we introduce these technologies into a new ecosystem? But it's going to be years, right, before we really understand what does that mean on, you know, someone's willingness to call the police, or does it really have a civilizing effect on the officers and the citizens?
We may never know if they don't collect the data on the impact.
Exactly.
Another question?
But I was just going to say, it's another place where we just have too much data.
Yeah.
Okay, video is ridiculously hard to go through and to find those spots. And so what we're working on right now, another piece of the Police Data Initiative, is looking at machine-readable ways to go through that data. so that it's actually of some value to supervisors. Because a supervisor, you know, after you've done an 8-hour shift or, you know, police officer's 12-hour shift, you don't then have time to look at video from the 10 officers that you just sent out in the street. I mean, you're just not going to do that. And so how do you give that supervisor clips so that the supervisor can say, this was a bad incident, this was a good incident, something that either we can learn from or something where an officer needs to be corrected on what their conduct was. There's no way to do that right now with the amount of video we have. How long do we keep this video for? Do we keep it for a week? Do we keep it for a month? Do we keep it for 2 months? And the cost. I mean, are we all willing to pay right now for the storage cost for all this video? And I can tell you, sat down with a number of Black Lives Matter activists to talk about body cameras. And for me, body cameras was a no-brainer because I've seen too many incidents. Again, when I was a civil rights prosecutor, we did police brutality along with hate crimes. Too many incidents where we just threw up our hands and said, we wish we had video. I've been involved in personal incidents where I wish there was video so that someone could actually understand the story I was telling them. But what do we do with those situations right now where police have video and months later start digging through it to identify people who were misbehaving and during a protest? I mean, that is what the Black Lives Matter people raised to me, which was something which I never even thought about. But holding this data for this extended period of time, you know, someday later we're going to have facial recognition technology that's going to be able to go through every piece of data, and you're going to say, what did so-and-so do 20 years ago? Is that where we want to be with our use of data, or do we want to cut it off at some point? And so I just think that it really is a community of practice thing is our best way forward.
Next question?
Yeah.
Do you have a microphone?
Hi, I'm Myra Rockymore, president of the Center for Global Policy Solutions, and also principal author of the Beyond Ferguson letter that was released in August of 2014 and was put on the president's desk and asked for some of these things, including the possibility of the administration actually leveraging their grant-making power to actually require data reporting. So I'm just curious as to, as you all well know, the other risk that we're facing is political risk. Time does change things. The policy window closes, and attention, public attention to these issues move forward, and we could find ourselves in another 20 years talking about the issue of voluntary data. And so my question is, what was the calculation that went into the decision not to leverage the administration's right to use its grant-making power to actually require this data? And we also know that Congress has a role in terms of mandating. And so I'm just wondering, what were the calculations that are going into this, and why was the decision made to lean back into this community of practice, volunteer community of practice structure?
You actually, in many ways, answered the question there, Maya, and that is that we don't have the ability to do so. Congress is the only one who can mandate that every single police department around the country actually publish data and publish it in a certain way. As an administration, we cannot do that. The Byrne JAG funding does not allow us. That'd be the biggest bucket of money that we would have. Everyone claims it'd be an unfunded mandate, and that we simply cannot require that anyone participate in the UCR program right now. That is a decision for Congress to make, and so we were really not left with a choice here as to whether to go voluntary or mandatory here. The only thing we had was to do it in a way that was voluntary. Now, we can incentivize it, we can put some things in the grants and say, you know, you get your grant money if you publish your data, but that's right now what the UCR program is. And we see how troubling the UCR data is. We have 90% of the agencies right now say that they have zero hate crimes. Out of 15,000 that reported said that they have zero hate crimes. They still get their Byrne JAG money even if they say zero. If they say one, they still get their Byrne JAG money. That's not something the administration can stop. This is, at the end of the day, it has to be done by Congress if it's going to happen at all. And I should note that I only have 241 days to deal with this anymore. The rest of you may have more. But that's it. But who's counting?
There's a question here in the front.
Hi, it's still Mark Rotenberg, although I'm wearing a slightly different hat on this question. I thought the last question was actually very important to this conversation, because when we're trying to assess data, there is, of course, a world of difference between voluntary data and different formats and different expectations and the data that can be mandated by Congress. For example, almost 50 years ago, the Federal Wiretap Act created comprehensive reporting requirements for prosecutors using electronic surveillance, and that's been very useful over the past 50 years to evaluate the effectiveness of electronic surveillance as a policing technique, and I think it could be extended to other types of policing techniques. But the hat I'm wearing at the moment actually is working on a panel for the National Academy of Sciences looking at the evidence-based policy determinations from federal agency data. And I think one of the preliminary conclusions is that the data that's produced by mandate over time is more objective and more reliable and simply more useful than the data that's, you know, provided on a voluntary basis. And so in support of the last question that was asked, I mean, do you think it would be a good strategy to try to move with Congress's support to a formal reporting requirements that would make it easier to evaluate body cameras and other new policing techniques?
I say both. I mean, because honestly, neither Congress nor the administration nor anybody is ready to put standards down on body cameras, for example. We just don't know enough about it. It's too soon to do so. At the same time, I would love to see mandatory data. I'm a big proponent of what's the National Incident-Based Reporting System, NIBRS. Many people don't realize NIBRS has been around for 40 years, and we still don't have full compliance. Finally, we have all of the agents, all the big organizations, IACP, major cities chiefs, national sheriffs, who've signed on to say in 5 years they'll be comfortable moving to NIBRS. At the pace that technology is moving, it's kind of crazy to me that we have to wait 5 years to get good crime data. So, yes, would I love for some of this to be mandated? Yes, I would. But at the same time, some of this is just so new that if we mandate it, we're going to be wrong, and people are going to start putting in place systems that they're not going to be able to change. It's going to be too expensive to change as we try to figure a lot of this stuff out.
I think we have time for one more question. Any more? There's one in the back. She's coming with the mic.
Thank you. I'm Andrea Holland with Case Commons. We build social network-based case management software for large public agencies that serve vulnerable children and families, child welfare, juvenile justice. Many of those agency directors are increasingly looking at predictive risk modeling to make their risk assessment procedures more efficient, more effective. And they're wary, but they're willing to try, provided that the frontline social worker, caseworker, and supervisor are still in the loop somehow. And I submit that that's the really hard part of this. Assuming that we can resolve issues with bias and surveillance with algorithms and with data, I think there's a third component that's so critical, and that is the UX, the user experience. Like, how do you feed model results, scores, rankings, to frontline workers in a way that gets the job done? And so I'm very interested to know if in criminal justice there are good examples of closing the loop and including frontline public servants in understanding algorithm results. And I submit it's more than just a simple nudge.
I mean, the way that the results are presented to judges, just as a comparison for risk assessment scores, is a bar chart. And it's like high is red out of 10 bars. And even when it's, so 6 and 5 is actually the average score, but it still looks red and like a lot of bars to a judge. So there are cases where judges have been misinterpreting these results. So I think you're right that UX is a big issue, but the problem is sort of deeper than that in the sense that the score itself is not that predictive, and predicting human behavior is insanely difficult. I mean, Facebook and Google are trying desperately to predict what you want to search for and what ads you want to look at, and I would say 50% of the time they're wrong, right? So how are you going to put life and death decisions in the hands of an algorithm that are, that it's just, it's a little early for that, I think, to be predicting human behavior, especially in things so risky like juveniles and children and incarceration, but that's my point of view, so.
I mean, I think it's an excellent point. I mean, it's something that I think about a lot. I mean, so DJ spoke earlier. He has this term that he calls data stupid. And he frequently gives the example of, you know, folks using the Google Maps, and if you look at the number of people who've, like, either driven into a lake or something like that, right? And just, like, completely turning over, you know, your autonomy and your decision-making to this device or to some algorithm. And it can certainly help you with decision-making, and it can help kind of guide the way. The thing that I worry about is this notion of completely removing the expertise of, and just the common sense and the empathy that should hopefully go along with a lot of these decisions and providing space for that. I would hope that the systems are designed in a way to still allow for that. My fear is that over time, as these things become easier and it's just accepted as more kind of mainstream, this is the way we do things, that we start to give more and more of our decision-making power away to something or someone that has no clue.
I would just say we're not doing a very good job right now in predicting. I don't know that machines are going to be all that much better, but at least we'll feel better that we're not guessing, which is unfortunate. But we really aren't. We're not figuring out who's going to be a successful kid. I mean, our teachers are getting it wrong sometimes in the classroom and our discipline decisions. Who we should release and who we should keep in jail for 20 years is something which we're getting wrong on a regular basis. I mean, we just got to keep working on this. But right now, we're not where we need to be, and we need to keep working on these things. And we got to figure out how we do a better job with data around the board across all the data sets we use.
I think we're out of time, but thank you very much, and thanks for our great panelists.
Thank you.